Heartbeat Alaska is brought to you in part by Coca-Cola.
By the generous support of the Alaska Native Health Board. And by the Public Information Office of the North Slope Borough. Welcome to Heartbeat Alaska. I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you Native news across the North. Thank you for joining me. On today's program, we have news from the North Slope Borough. We travel to villages, White Mountain, Tuluksak, and Yuzinki. All that plus more news from all over the North. But first, here's Gary Fife with National Native News.
This is National Native News. I'm Gary Fife. Senator Daniel Inouye, chair of the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, says the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act may be close to getting its first major revision. Under the 1988 law, tribes that are in states in which any form of gambling is allowed may seek to negotiate compacts with the state governments to allow gaming on their reservations. Since its enactment 5 years ago, high-stakes gaming has been a point of contention between state and tribal governments. State governments say they should have more control of gaming within their borders, and tribes say such control is an infringement on their sovereignty. Inouye says once the proposed changes that have been submitted by state governors have been reviewed, he expects tribal and state concerns to be resolved. The biggest Native lobbying group in this country heard from one of the leaders of its counterpart in Canada. The National Congress of American Indians was in Reno, Nevada, formulating new policies for the coming year. Tony McCready, Grand Chief of the Grand Council of First Nations in Canada, addressed assembled tribal delegates about the United Nations declared Year of Indigenous Peoples. He said it's important for natives in the U.S. and Canada to forge a united voice that will be heard internationally. McCready says, in closing, he extended an invitation to host a future NCAI convention in Canada. The Native American Graves Repatriation and Protection Act set a deadline for museums to notify tribes whose artifacts were taken from them. That deadline was November 16th. As a result, the Sitka Tribe of Alaska expects to get thousands of Etchinkit artifacts returned. Bureau of Indian Affairs police in Wyoming say that the recent Associated Press investigative report on BIA police brutality was inaccurate. BIA officials at the Wind River Agency, David Allison and Captain Larry Makeshine, say that their officers did not engage in brutality as alleged. In one specific case where videotape and medical reports show the effects of injuries sustained by an intoxicated woman during her arrest, Makeshine says his officers never used any more force than was required in such arrests. He added that five officers have been injured in the line of duty in the past several years. The AP report covered 17 incidents on several reservations in the Northern Plains region. The story of Lisa Tiger, the young Muscogee Creek woman who is battling an HIV infection, is available on video. She was infected in 1992 and has taken up the cause of fighting the AIDS-HIV infection among natives. The video's target audience is native youth who are unaware or simply indifferent about the dangers of the deadly virus. The video, "If It Can Happen to Me, It Can Happen to You," is available from the United Indian Tribal Youth Group in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, for a cost of $28. Part of the proceeds go toward Tiger's medical expenses. And finally, a group of young Lakota women at Bennett County High School have decided to express their identity with a drill team. Indian Country USA reported the team called Sweet Reality was formed by Sari and Corey Trimble to offer a popular activity for young Native women. They say they want to act as drug-free and sober role models for their peers. While not exactly cheerleaders for the school, the six-member Sweet Reality performs dance line routines at school events and Native gatherings. This is National Native News, and for Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Gary Fife.
Thanks, Gary. We'll be seeing more of Gary next week, of course, and also on my Christmas special, so make sure you catch that. We'll be back with more news from Heartbeat Alaska right after these messages.
Wow! Party got here just in time. Hi, I'm Ginny Green. Welcome to Heartbeat Alaska's Christmas special. Greetings from all over the state.
Heartbeat Alaska is the only Native news aired statewide, owned by Natives, produced by Natives, staffed by Natives.
What?
I forgot my line. Heartbeat Alaska is the only Native news aired statewide, owned by Natives, produced by Natives, staffed by Natives, for Natives, about Natives. But our stories appeal to everyone.
If you have news or information from your village or community, please call Heartbeat Alaska, area code 907-563-3507, or fax 907-563-7079.
And now, here's news from the North Slope Borough's Public Information Office. Let's find out what's happening at the top of the world.
The North Slope Borough Village Coordinators met in Borough last week for 3 days of orientation with representatives from each of the borough departments. Mayor George Mawak recently announced the appointment of village coordinators on a new job share basis. The job sharing program will help to employ as many people as possible in the villages with available jobs.
But the village coordinators are something that had started during my administration in the past. This time, instead of having one village coordinator, we're having two village coordinators, and we're working this out on a job sharing program for the first time and implementing a policy from the mayor's office to hire more people at the village level. So the mayor's village coordinators, there's two at the village, 1 week on, 1 week off, and the village is very happy about having somebody in the village constantly while the other one is out doing business and so forth.
Mayor Amawat has also reinstituted the mayor's jobs program.
One of the goals is to employ local residents as much as possible, and we have instituted the mayor's jobs program all over again and went to the North Slope Borough Assembly for funding. And the mayor's jobs program that we're hiring now, we're budgeting 433 new positions.
The mayor has additional plans to assist village economies. He is working with contractors to increase local hire of qualified workers on capital improvement projects, such as new home construction. He is also making changes in the hiring policies and application requirements to make it easier for villagers to qualify for local jobs. Polar bears, whose continuing presence near town caused concern for Borough residents in 1992, are stuck in North Slope communities again this year. North Slope Borough, Alaska Fish and Game, and U.S. Fish and Wildlife officials examined a carcass of a bear which injured a dew line worker at Ulictuk on November 30th. The bear attacked after breaking through a window at the facility's recreation center. The bear was shot and killed by another worker. The results of the examination showed that the bear was very thin with an empty stomach. It also had an abscessed wound on its rump. The bear's head was sent out by a veterinarian to be examined for rabies. Koptovik residents have reported bears near the village, and Borough residents have been seeing bears near town for weeks. The Borough is operating bear patrols and has been running radio announcements warning the public to be alert and asking parents not to leave children outdoors unattended. The Borough has also been working on disposing of inedible meat in scraps in Borough. The holidays are nearly here, and in Borough, that means it's time for the annual Christmas games. The holiday events provide several days of fun and competition in traditional games, such as the 1 and 2 foot high kick, seal hop, and other tests of strength and endurance. Many of the events featured in the Christmas games were created originally as training exercises for survival in the Arctic.
Especially today that these games are still in very much use, very much in effect in our way of life, our subsistence lifestyle. Some of these games help us to be aware of the surroundings and to be in top physical and mental state. And that's why these games were given to us by our ancestors.
After the holidays, North Slope residents will have just a few weeks to catch their breath before another big event. Akivyat, a traditional winter festival, has been called for January 27th through the 29th in Borough. Kivyat is the Inupiat celebration of a bountiful year. Traditionally, the village holding a kivyat sent messengers to invite other villages for dancing, feasting, and trading. Runners representing the villages raced to see who would win the place of honor in the kadri, or community house, where kivyat was held and the right to hold the next kivyat. Starting with kivyat 1994, runners representing dance groups will race for the honor of hosting kivyat. The winning dance group will provide a representative to help MC the festivities. 15 dance groups, including King Islanders and Russians, have been invited this year. Other Kivyat activities include bartering and trading and gift giving and storytelling. Kivyat is coordinated and sponsored by the North Slope Borough. That's all the news from the North Slope. Kuyanakpak.
Thank you, Marie Adams, and thank you, Mark Olson, producer of the North Slope Borough News, produced in Borough, Alaska, from the Public Information Office. That must have been really scary to look up and see a polar bear looking in the window, but then again, that's life in Alaska. I'd like to say hello to some people I met recently, Pauline and Mary Roberts from Quinnahawk, and also the Matthews. Hello, and thank you for watching Heartbeat Alaska. We travel now to the Anupiat village of White Mountain, a village located on the Fish River.
The village of White Mountain is located about 75 miles east of the town of Nome. Until approximately 1875, the village was located upriver. According to stories told by the current village elders, the villagers had a long history of war with the Yukon tribes. That included many bloody battles, the last of which occurred about 1860. Many of the Anupiat people who live in this area are part of the Fish River tribe.
These fish right here, this mass, supposed to represent this area, Fish River, where the Fish River tribe, White Mountain people. You know, we're along the Fish River, so I put fish on my masks. They go like this feather would come off right here, and I would have a fish up here, and then I would have another one down here, and one over here, and one over here that represents our tribe.
Tony Shuganarak lives in White Mountain. He's a mask carver, carrying on the ancient tradition of the original people of this area. White Mountain was originally named Nutshervik, an Anupiat word which roughly translated means the place of the mountain, but was later changed to White Mountain because of the color of the rock atop an adjoining hill. In the mid-1860s, gold was discovered upriver from White Mountain. During the winter of 1917 to 1918, the flu epidemic hit the Norton Sound area with a vengeance. but White Mountain was spared. According to historical records, two people had high fevers, but no one in the village died. Today, around 190 people live in White Mountain, famous for being one of the checkpoints on the Iditarod Trail. Tony Shoogukwruk ran it in 1991.
We need more dog mushers in Iditarod. We're the people that started the dog mushing, you know. Mm-hmm. We're the ones that perfected it, not Susan Butcher, not Rick Swenson, not Rick Mackey. Mm-hmm. They got it from us. They got it from Herbie Nyackbuck. They got it from all our people, all our ancestors that were running dogs for years. They perfected it from us, but we're the ones that started it, and we're the ones that used to go 1,000 miles. We lived with dogs.
In the Iditarod race, for native mushers and non-native mushers, one of the biggest obstacles is getting sponsorship.
I'll do it again if I get sponsors. It's hard to run a race. It's hard for us native people to run races, because we don't have the backup the other people have. I've been saying that for years, and I won't quit saying it. We can have good Alaskan natives running Iditarod if we just get the backup, if we get the people behind us, our people too.
I'd like to thank Holly Masters for that video and Mr. Gary Crandall for the written history of White Mountain. Some of you viewers may remember White Mountain as the location of a boarding high school in the 1940s. Speaking of White Mountain, I understand that they're not getting RatNet. The satellite dish is broken down. So if you're in one of the surrounding villages, such as Golovin, please have one of the people in White Mountain call me when their satellite dish is working once again. That way I can re-air this story just for them. We turn now to a little further south, to the Yupik village of Tuluksak in southwestern Alaska. The Yupik village of Tuluksak has a new library. On November 18th, the library was officially opened.
On behalf of the people of Tuluksak, the Yupik School District Board of Education, and your Advisory Board of Education, Andrew and I are officially, by our action, opening the community library at Tuluksak. If these scissors will.
The superintendent of the Yupik School District, Mr. Dishman, and Andrew B. Alexei, the chairman of the local advisory school board, officially cut the ribbon at 1:30 in the afternoon. Tuluksak has around 350 residents, and many of them were there standing in line waiting to check out the new 2,000 square foot library.
You love my classroom?
I love it.
Everyone was excited about the move, especially the 7th and 8th grade classes, since they were going to be the new occupants of the old library. The village of Tuluksak is located on the Kuskokwim River, about 36 miles from Bethel in western Alaska. Most of the residents of the village are Yupik Eskimos. The natives are proud of their culture, and the Yupik language can be heard everywhere in the village. Most of the parents make sure the children grow up learning how to understand and speak the native language. The Yupik people are an adaptable people. They mix the conveniences of the Western culture with their own subsistence lifestyle. Ice fishing can be done by one person. However, one of the greatest strengths of the Yupik people is their ability to work together. Many people in the community pitched in to help move the materials from the old library to the new one. Almost anywhere, a brand new community and school library is reason for celebration. Tuluksak may be a small village, but they do things in a big way, like getting involved in the education of their children. There are over 100 students in grades kindergarten through 12, and the village and the school work together through the Onward to Excellence program, which is a process by which the schools and communities get together and establish goals for the schools, emphasizing the tradition of their own culture.
Marry money, do On November 18th, the festivities ended with a huge banquet at the high school. Once again, the whole village coming together to celebrate. The next day, on November 19th, Velma Wallace, a native author from Fort Yukon, was in Tuluksak to read to the students from her newly published book, Two Old Women. She took time out to talk with the students about how one becomes a writer and stressed to them the importance of keeping their oral tradition alive. Launching the opening of the new library, the Tuluksak Way.
But the deep cold of winter presented special problems. The moose, their favorite source of food, took refuge from the penetrating cold.
Thank you, Wayne Gerke, for the video from Tuluksak. As you saw in the story, Velma Wallace wrote Two Old Women. It's a Athabascan legend about two women. It's about courage, betrayal, and survival. Very, very good. I recommend it. We'll be back with Elise Patkotak and her commentary from Borough right after these messages.
Ki, olar nasi, kini ktof sa nagtusi sa magjini kuin piyanganik apoyom. Kuyana, tekuva. Ki.
Many times our Alaska Native culture is lost through alcohol and drug abuse. At Aquila House, we can help you regain your life as well as your heritage too. We use a holistic treatment approach for physical, mental, and spiritual values to come back to you. Kunashchish.
If you need long-term treatment for alcohol and drug addiction, the Aquila House can help you. We are a 53-bed therapeutic community and have recently added a Native services. So call us, Kiana.
Christmas greetings are starting to pour in. Thank you very much. We could still hear from many more villages, so please continue to send them in. Let's turn now to Borough with Elise Patkotak.
Holidays will always mean one thing to me, the dulcet tone of the telephone company's latest computerized operator saying, "I'm sorry, all circuits are busy now. Will you please hang up and try your call again later?" When you spend an inordinate amount of your holiday time hitting the redial button on your phone, you have lots of time to think. You wonder how late you can be to your holiday dinner party. You wonder if your host and hostess will understand that you have to get this call through before you can enjoy any of the festivities. Why? Well, because it's impossible to enjoy the good cheer and fellowship of a holiday meal knowing that somewhere back east, your mother is sitting at the family table talking about you in the past tense. She'll be saying things that sound suspiciously like a eulogy. She'll start asking your sister what part of your inheritance she'd like when the will is changed. If you're lucky, you get your call through just before your cousin, the lawyer, is asked to formally make the needed adjustments to the document. But once you get through, the conversation you have makes the wait worthwhile, right? Or do you get the echo line too? In a typical conversation on the echo line, which, by the way, seems to be the only long-distance line my phone can access on the holidays, all speech passes over the wire at the same time, no matter how long either party waits to speak. Conversation usually consists of phrases like, "What did you say? No, no, you go first, I'll wait. You're starring in a nude musical. Oh, you're starting the food now." The comments make no sense whatsoever until one of you gives up and says, "Well, have a happy holiday. Maybe I'll make a pre-recorded holiday message and send it to them. I'll get about five friends to talk into a microphone at the same time. It will sound exactly like a holiday call home. Merry Christmas to everyone and Happy Hanukkah."
Thank you, Elise. Patkotak from Borough. I'd like to say a special hello to Mr. David Phillips from the village of Perryville, Alaska. Earlier, we had mentioned that we would be visiting the village of Yuzinki. We'll have that on next week. If you're at home during the Christmas time, make sure you start getting those decorations up right now. It'll put you in the spirit. Isn't it great this year? We're so blessed to be here for Christmas. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Jeannie Green. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll see you next week.